months. The parents agreed to face the media. Megyn Kelly picks up the story from there.
It was a little more than 7 months ago that America Live first reported on the disappearance of a 10-month-old baby girl that the rest of the national media would soon refer to as Baby Lisa. The Lisa Irwin case quickly attracted enormous attention, in part because of a powerful news conference with her parents, and in part because of the shocking and unusual nature of the claims that someone had actually broken into a house and kidnapped a little baby while her family slept. At the height of the investigation, hundreds of local, county, state, and federal law enforcement were involved in searching ravines, fields, and the area around a nearby river. And I had the chance to travel to the Irwin home, look at the crime scene, talk with police, and sit down for an extensive interview with little Lisa's parents. Now the Irwin's legal team says they are trying to draw attention to what they believe is a new lead in this case. And Lisa's parents, Jeremy Irwin and Deborah Bradley, as well as their lawyer, Joe Tacopina, are giving their first national media interviews in months. They join me now. Welcome, all of you. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having us.
Deborah, let me start with you. It's been, you know, a few months since you and I sat down together, and I want to know how you are.
There's no words to describe what we feel and what goes through our minds every day. There is not a second in the day that I don't think about her and where she's at and how she's doing and what kind of living condition she's in and who has her and how long it's going to take to get her home.
I think a lot of our viewers would be wondering, you know, how they could function, how they could function.
You don't have a choice. You don't have a choice. If I fall apart, then I can't find Lisa. I'm no good. And I'm no good to my two boys that are home waiting for her, too. Mm-hmm.
Jeremy, you say that you believe that there's a lead in the case that you want pursued. Now, it's something that's new to us. It's not that new to you. But it relates right. to an attempted use of your debit card about a month after Lisa went missing on November 6th. What did you see? At what company was your card attempted to be used?
On November 6th, my debit card was used successfully. For a website that allows you to change your name and change children's names online over the internet. And from what I understand, they're accepted by the United Kingdom Passport Company, and it went through and appeared to be a legitimate purchase. So they were they charged $69 to one of my cards, and We're wondering, you know, what's going on with that. We're not getting any answers. And we found out about it in the middle of December, and we haven't heard anything. Mm-hmm. We just keep getting the standard repeated. It's been checked into. We're checking into it. But, you know, I think it's time that we get some answers from somebody.
This is from the police saying we checked into it.
Correct.
Joe, we looked into this ourselves, the URL that you guys gave us, right. And at first we pulled up a stationery company, but when we went back and did some digging, we did see that that stationery company's name, at least, or its URL address, was somehow connected to a website that allows you to change your name or your baby's name. But Jeremy's debit card wasn't stolen on the night little Lisa went missing.
You know, you're right, but there's really so many coincidences in this case, Megan, and this is just another one that has to be answered. There's ways to find out who attempted to make that charge on that credit card, to make it appear that, you know, deflect attention away from someone else, to make it appear that they were trying to somehow change their child's name. I mean, it was a fraudulent charge. Mm-hmm. That's why the credit card company stopped it. There were things that weren't matching on the addresses and whatnot. And there's a way to do that, because you can find out the IP address of the computer that attempted to do it. You know, we don't have that power. We've turned this over to the law enforcement mm-hmm. agencies who are investigating. You know, we haven't heard anything, and it's just another coincidence in this case. I mean, could it be nothing? Could it be an empty lead? Perhaps. But when you start adding things up, when you take that unbelievable coincidence where we have a missing baby and there's a charge, a fraudulent charge on some website that actually changes children's names over the internet, which is unbelievable to me that exists. Mm-hmm. When you couple that with the 1157 call from Deb's phone, the phone that went missing with baby Lisa that night, 11:57, a half hour after this individual, Jersey Joe, got off of work, there's a phone call to a Megan Wright who we now know is Jersey Joe's on-again, off-again girlfriend. Mm-hmm. Someone who Deborah doesn't know. Megan said that she doesn't know Deborah. And that's the first time that phone ever dialed this Megan Wright's number. And that phone went missing with the baby. So you then say, well, does Jersey Joe have something to do with it? When you couple that with the fact that three human beings, eyewitnesses who have nothing to do with this family, who seem, by all accounts, very credible, have made identifications of post-midnight that night, an individual matching the description of this Jersey Joe walking with a baby and just a diaper on in the middle of October in Kansas City.
We spoke with two of them, the neighbors who live around the corner from you, and they maintained to us that that is what they saw shortly after you said she went missing, that they saw a man who was balding, which Jersey Joe was on the night in question. He had a close-shaved head with a baby right around the time that she would have gone missing. But the police say they have moved on from Jersey
Joe. How can
Joe?
You move on from something like that? We want answers. We understand that they have a job to do. The KCPD has a job to do. The FBI has a job to do. But it's been almost 8 months since we've seen our daughter. We want answers, and we want Lisa, and we're not going away until that happens, until she comes home.
Do you feel like they've wasted time taking such a hard look at the two of you?
Absolutely. I understand the initial looking at us initially. This world is a really messed up place. Obviously, someone came in and stole my child. I understand that bad people exist. You see it on the news all the time as well. But, you know, after about a month or so, and with all the things Joe just mentioned, you would think that they would start looking elsewhere. Now, maybe they have, and I don't know about it. I mean, I talk to the FBI over the phone consistently, almost routinely. But it is frustrating when you feel like you're not getting any answers. It's like, well, where are they looking? What are they doing?
I know some of my viewers are going to be listening to you thinking, well, they wouldn't have taken such a hard look at you if you had been honest about your drinking from the beginning.
I was honest. I told them that. Just because I didn't say it on TV doesn't mean I didn't tell the cops that right up front.
Did you tell them that you'd had between 5 and 10 glasses of wine?
Yes, I did.
And that you were possibly blacked out?
Yes, I did.
Did you tell them that you had last seen little Lisa at 6:40 initially or at 10:40 initially?
I said that I put her to bed around 6:40. I said I wasn't sure if I checked on her after that when I went to bed at 10:30.
You originally, as I recall, said that you had checked on her at 10:40, and then when you spoke to the media months later, you said maybe I didn't check on her. That was a reversal in the case, and it was a big one.
No, and I understand how that looks, and what people don't get is that when you're faced in a room with all these cameras, and it's not like it's hard to remember because you're telling a story. I'm telling the truth. It's just that sometimes when you're talking to somebody and all these cameras are in the room and everything like that, you just kind of fumble over your words. And it really was just an honest mistake. I'm not lying. I have not lied this entire time.
And Megan, I'm going to jump in at this point. I'll let you do your little cross-examination and ask these tough questions. I didn't jump in. But, you know, I'm tired of hearing people condemn her. She's a woman who lost her baby. Mm-hmm. I mean, for 10 seconds, someone try and walk in those shoes and understand what she's been through. And you saw that first initial press conference where she couldn't even speak. So the fact that she didn't recall if she actually checked on her baby that night at 10:40, she always maintained she put her to bed at around 6:40. Mm-hmm. The question was, did you check on her when you went to bed? She didn't recall that at first. Maybe she said she did later, but that's the point is she doesn't recall when she left her. But it was certainly.
No, what happened, Joe? I remember this. What happened was she originally told law enforcement, or the initial reports were that she last saw the baby at 10:40.
That never was the said time. That. See, that's the problem.
That was the timeline that we were dealing with according to the cops.
Well, the cops didn't see. That's what the cops have put out there through either some spokesperson. But I spoke with the FBI. I understand the timing of their statements.
I know,
We've never seen those statements.
I spoke with your client as well, but there was no question in it early on that the initial report was that she had last checked on the baby at 10:40, Joe. And then when I sat down with her, she said, actually, I don't know whether I checked on her at 10:40 or not. I went to bed at 6:40. You're getting lost in the weeds. I just wanted to raise it with Deb. I just wanted to raise it with Deb because I know my viewers cared about that point.
Right.
And I want to give you the chance to address it. It's not a cross-examination. I'm just asking what my viewers were about.
She's here to answer any questions. But again, this is, I think, why we've lost so many precious moments in this case. case. You have live witnesses identifying a man matching a person who happened to be calling from Deb's cell phone, his on-again, off-again girlfriend, which went missing with the baby. Three human beings who are witnesses to that, seeing a baby after midnight in Kansas City with just a diaper on. And we're focusing on whether she remembered if she checked the baby at 10:40. I just think it was a little misguided. I think from the beginning, this investigation's been misguided.
See, that's how it is in with news today. It's all about entertainment. I mean, and people will pick it apart and speculate, and it's the way things are. I had no idea until this had happened, and we were on TV ourselves.
Thank you. Thank you, all three.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.